Good morning, everyone. Why don't we stand this morning? Amen. The Lord is good, isn't he? What a beautiful day it is outside. Looks like everyone's enjoying it. Hallelujah. Amen. Why don't we lift our hands and ask the Lord to touch us today as we enter into his presence together. As a body, we love you, Lord Jesus. We thank you for your goodness and mercy in our life. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the opportunity we have to lift you up, proclaim you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords of our life. Lord Jesus, we acknowledge our need for you. We can't live life without you. We can't do anything without you. So we acknowledge that. We proclaim that. And Lord Jesus, we reach our hands for you today, God, with open hearts and open minds, God, to receive from you, but also to give to you, give you glory, honor, and power. For you're worthy, Lord, to receive that. We thank you, Lord Jesus. You're good to us. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say amen. Amen. Why don't you turn around to two or three people? Maybe find somebody that you don't know. Shake their hand. Amen. And greet them in the name of Jesus. Let them know you're glad to be in the house of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Riding on the clouds, shining We worship you this morning, Jesus, because there truly is none that can compare to you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You are our Savior. You're Alpha, you're Omega. You are the beginning, you are the end. You are the one true God. You are our Prince of Peace. You are our hope, our joy, our everything, Lord Jesus. And God, we magnify you in this house this morning. We magnify you, Lord God. We give you all praise. We give you all honor, God, because that's what's due unto you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And we say, Lord, you're holy.
Come on, let's lift him up. He's so worthy. Hallelujah. Our King of Kings, our Lord of Lords, our Maker is such an awesome God. You believe that this morning? Come on, I wonder if we could just lift up our hands and just tell Him how awesome He is. You're awesome, Lord Jesus. You're awesome in my life. You're awesome in this church. And we want to tell you about it today, Lord Jesus. We want to tell you how awesome you are this morning, God. Oh, you're an awesome God. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He can move mountains.
In the valley.
Oh,
hide me from the rain.
My God
is awesome.
He heals me.
When I'm broken.
Oh, don't you know
where I've been weeping?
Oh, yes, Lord. Come on, let's sing that again. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He can move a mountain.
In the valley.
Oh, and
he hides me from the rain.
From the rain, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken.
Oh, he's my strength.
Strength where I've been weak.
Oh, forever.
Forever.
Oh, come on, let's sing. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Oh, just tell him this morning, he's awesome.
Awesome.
Oh, my God is awesome.
Awesome.
Oh, yes, He is.
Awesome.
He's an awesome God.
My God is awesome.
Oh, He's so awesome, Lord.
Awesome.
So thankful, Lord, for who You are. Sing it again. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
He's your Savior.
Savior of the world.
He's a giver of salvation.
Giver of salvation.
If you're not feeling good today,
by His stripes
you're healed. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Today I am.
Today I am forgiven.
It's because of His grace.
Grace is why I'm living.
My God is awesome, yes He is. move the mountain. He'll keep you in your valley. Oh, he'll hide you from the rain. Oh, my God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
Oh, he's my strength. Forever. Come on, let's sing it again. My God is awesome.
My God is awesome.
What's your mountain look like this morning? What's your valley look like right now? He can protect you and hide you from the rain.
My God is awesome.
Oh, he's my healer. His strength when I've been weak.
Praise his holy name.
Oh, hallelujah. Come on, if he's awesome to you this morning, just tell him about it. You're awesome, Lord. You're awesome, Jesus. You're worthy, Jesus. You're awesome, Lord. You're great, God. Yes, you are. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, my God is awesome. My God is mighty. Oh, he's holy. He's awesome. Yes, he is. Oh, he's a great God. He's a holy God. He's a righteous God. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. My God is awesome. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. We have a Savior, church. Are you glad we have a Savior? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He heals us when we're broken. Hallelujah. 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 We don't have to worry about any mountains that are in our way because we have a Savior. Hallelujah. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And his presence is with us today. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what our struggle is. When we follow him, when we serve him, he receives us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible said in the book of Luke chapter 9 that they followed him into a desert place and he received them. And then he healed all those that needed healing. Praise God. We have a wonderful, wonderful God and Father that cares about his children. Amen. Praise God. Our God is awesome, and we're going to go to him in prayer. You may be seated. Sarah and Kara, for their friend Ashley, who ran away. This is a victory report. And after prayer, they came back, and everything is really going well. Melanie Kathy, victory report. She had an eye problem that was caught in time, and she's not going to need surgery. Amen. We rejoice with our sister. And she also wants us to continue to pray for her, that everything continues to go in the right direction. And also for her co-worker, Aaron, that has the same problem. Praise God for our Savior. Amen. Sister Jackie Forbes, for Scott Forbes, needs a healing from high blood pressure. Mona Lisa, for healing and salvation for William Josephson. Pauline Graham for Josephine Smith is in Adventist Hospital, has a blood clot. We pray God's healing upon her. And Pauline Graham for Sister Audrey Bailey needs a healing.
Sister Pauline Graham for Sybil Barrett needs a healing. And Bernice Lawson for Minnie Cox is suffering from a fever and aches and pains, and we want God to touch her. Amen.
We have several here. Deborah King, would you just raise your hand there so people can see where you are? She is, as you know, most of you know, suffering with multiple sclerosis. She's been battling with it for quite some time. And it seems to be kind of encroaching more and more. We do have a situation here with her. And it's a very wearisome thing. It's a constant pain, loss of strength. And I would like us to really take her on very seriously, not just for a prayer today, but in our prayer times at home. Amen. To strengthen that whole family, her daughter, her husband. Great people. And how do you explain the unexplainable? You know, sometimes God heals, sometimes he doesn't. And when he doesn't, he's got a purpose in that. And all of you know, should know, that we don't grow in our relationship with God when things are going good. We grow in suffering if we respond to it correctly.
Amen.
And so I'd like you very much to pray for her so that she gets some relief.
Amen.
Everybody say relief.
Relief.
It's spelled J-E-S-U-S.
Amen.
Amen. I feel something happening on her right now.
Praise.
Why don't you lift your hands,
Jesus,
up, Deborah, you, in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Just say, I receive, Lord.
I receive.
Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Thank you for virtue flowing.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Strengthen her husband, daughter. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
You believe God can heal?
Amen.
And he can comfort us. When he doesn't heal, he can comfort us.
Amen.
Amen. Couple more. Sybil Barrett, a member of our congregation for quite a while. She's had cancer surgery. I don't think she's here. Sybil, are you here? And she's got a long recuperation time, and want us to pray for her. And Bernice Lawson, are you up there in the choir? Yes. Bernice is experiencing some difficulty today, and I'd like us to pray for her. Okay, that's it for me.
All right. If you're in this congregation here today and you need prayer, please stand right now. Amen. Even if you didn't put a prayer request in, we're asking you to stand if you have a need here today. We want to lift you up in your need to the Lord right now. He's here. He's here, church, and it's rich. His presence is rich in this place. Praise God. Amen. All right, church, you see these that are standing? Let's go to them. Hallelujah. In faith. Let's believe God in faith with them, with our brothers and sisters, and lift them up. Everybody find someone to pray with. Brother, pray with brother, sister with sister. Let's everybody find someone to lift up to the Lord today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. All right, church, let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for being so awesome in this place today, God. Hallelujah. Thank you for moving the mountains that are in our lives, God. They're trying to block our pathway to you, God. We thank you for removing the mountains. Hallelujah. We thank you for healing, God, that's in his place right now. Your virtue, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for being our provider, our deliverer, our way maker. Hallelujah. Our Savior. Hallelujah. Thank you for saving us, God. In the name of Jesus, thank you for your love toward your people here today, God. Thank you for peace upon all those that are struggling today. Hallelujah. Thank you for healing Minnie Cox, God. Thank you for touching Bernice Lawson, God. Healing. Thank you for what you're doing. Right now, God, your miracle power on Deborah King, God. And Brother Gregory, God. We lift up Brother Gregory to you, God. And thank you for strengthening him and healing him. In Jesus' name, touch this Sybil Barrett, God. Hallelujah. Thank you for a total healing from cancer. Thank you for healing Sister Audrey Bailey. Josephine Smith, God. William Joseph, God. Thank you for healing Scott Forbes from this high blood pressure, God. Thank you for healing Melanie Cathy and her co-worker, God, from these eye problems, God. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. We have faith, God. We believe. We believe in your miracle power in our lives. We believe in your healing touch, God. Hallelujah. You're our provider, our way maker, our healer. You're our everything, and we lift you up. We worship you. We glorify you. That's it. Let's clap our hands unto him. Let's give him glory. Let's give him honor. Let's give him praise today. Hallelujah. 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 Don't hold back. He don't hold back. Don't hold back. Give him glory. Come on. Let's praise him. He's worthy. He's worthy. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you for being our Savior. Hallelujah. One more time. Let's clap our hands unto him. In thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. You can remain standing. We're going to go to the Lord in our giving. We're going to worship him. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us it's more blessed to give than to receive. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. God is pouring out of his spirit here today. He's a giver. And if we want to be like him, we need to go all out like he goes all out for us. Let's give of our substance to the Lord today. Let's not hold back. Let's give in faith today, knowing that he's got us covered. Hallelujah. That we have a Savior, that we have a provider, that he's everything. Amen. Everybody march. Follow the direction of your ushers. They have envelopes if you need them. Let's give unto the Lord. Let's give them a great offering today beside our tithes and missions and everything. Amen. Let's march as our musicians play. Amen. Amen. Stretch forth your hands toward the offering, and let's ask the Lord to bless our giving. Father, we praise you with this offering right now, God. We worship you because you're a loving God, because you're our provider, and just because you are our Father, we love you and honor you, and we obey you in this giving of our tithes, our offerings, God. We lift it up to you. We ask you to bless it and multiply it for your kingdom's sake. God, thank you for your favor in our lives. Thank you for continuing to move us forward. Thank you for blessing this giving. In Jesus' name, and everybody say amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Morato. And several very, very important announcements I want to make today. So I'd like your undivided attention. And this is very important. Number one, this will be the last time that we open the door for single-parent ministry. There is a brochure for you in the foyer if you'd like more information about it. If you're a single adult with children or child, male or female, we're getting ready to launch a ministry for you to be a support group, a help, a strength, and lift up your hands, and a great curriculum. So this is, we're going to close it after this, and also with the Discovery Bible study that I'll be teaching for those of you that have signed up. We have about 10, and I'm thankful for that. This is also the last time that we're going to open this up. I don't want that to be a totally big class. And so if you are interested in being in my discovery class, which is a 5-lesson Bible study, if you will get with Brother Morato, can you be out there? Well, brother, okay. So you can see him right after service. Also, Sister Wood will be in the foyer to give you these pamphlets and sign you up for the course. Now, what we're going to do is we will poll you and help find out how many can meet on early Sunday morning before church or Saturday morning mornings. I prefer the Saturday mornings personally, but we want to take care of everybody, so we want to make those two options available for you. And very, very important that we do that. And so also, I think I must have left. Sorry about that. And I appreciate everybody that was in the prayer room today before church, and for everybody that was here on time. The rest of you, we're glad you made it. Next week is Mother's Day, and we're going to celebrate Mother's Day and honor all of our mothers with a gift. This is a great time to reach out to a lot of people that maybe don't normally come. Call your aunt a mother for a week or whatever, and bring them to the house of God. We're going to pray over them. We're going to honor them and give them a gift. That's next week. All right? Tonight. Everybody say tonight. How do you say that in Espanol? Por noche? Right there on the road. So we are having a very important church service tonight. Pastor Sean is rolling out our next phase from reboot into this next phase. We talked about it in our midweek service and reminding all of you that we do have a midweek service on Wednesday. We expect our membership to be there. It's a very important teaching service. And tonight, he's going to be rolling out this new phase that will run through the day of Pentecost, or Pentecostal Sunday. And we're going to have, he's going to talk a lot about it tonight. And if this is your church, I'm asking you to be back here tonight so that you can get this information and plug in. Can somebody say amen? So please be here. Also, we have in the foyer those two Sundays that we had all the healings on that one Sunday, a lot of emotional, physical healings. He got healed the next Sunday, and that young man that came up, and you'll remember that. We have a two-set DVD collection that you can get in the foyer. Kitty, are you in here? Can you make sure somebody's taking care of that? You have them, right? Okay. Now, they're not free. They're $5 for the both of them. And I suggest you get one. I don't have that many, maybe 15. But I suggest you get one and watch it and recapture that moment. And then use those DVDs for your friends to share with them what's going on around here. And that's a very important thing, and you can pick them right after service. And if this is your first, second, third, or fourth visit with us, we're glad that you're here and have come back. And we are delighted that you're here. We also want to invite you to our guest reception after the service. If you go down the middle of the aisle, turn to the right, there'll be people there to meet with you. We have gifts for you, and we have some refreshments for you, and some nourishment and some pamphlets and stuff. So you'll enjoy that, and I know you'll be glad for it. I want to let our Spanish contingency know, if you don't know, that we have translation taking place during the teaching and the preaching of the word. If you have friends that can't speak English, bring them, because we can hook them up to get that tool to be able to understand in Espanol. And we have that on Wednesday, and we have that on Sunday nights also. So please make yourself available to that. And I've got, can you believe I'm doing this again? These are not Holy Ghost and baptism. These are people that started the journey. And when you start our journey class, you are moving toward ministry and full membership. Did he want me to do this? Okay. And so these folks have launched into the journey class, and the first segment of the journey class is called our orientation. It's a 4-hour class with a lunch in between, a nice lunch. We have it catered from Ruth's Chris Steakhouse. So you want to get involved with that. And you get two steaks when you come. Now, if you can believe that, you can believe for anything. And so these are folks that have launched. Most have opted to become members, general members. And we'd like you to come as quickly as you can. And Lena, Michelle, I can't get it right. I know I'm not right on that, but please forgive me. And she finished that course. Also, Victoria Davis took that first part of that class and is a general member in our church. And a popular one. Also, Jose Trofito. He has taken that first part, orientation, and he has become a general member in our church. This is the ones that excited me the most. And they're on their way. We have a 3-stair process of membership: general, community, and covenant. And we have several covenants here that I'm pleased to present, and that would be Shiona Thompson. Also, very popular. Merle Reese, right here. And Isaac Yon. I'm ready. Monique, I'm done. And don't forget these pamphlets on what? Oh, yes. Oh, one more. And it's become popular to get a certificate of baptism. And we haven't done that for years. And we decided at Easter we would do it for Easter. And we had 15 or 16 get the Holy Ghost and several baptized. And other folks noticed they didn't get it when they got baptized. And so they wanted one. And we've got one for Mary Ellen Dixon. And we really appreciate her and her husband. They're great people. And we have some for your sons that are in the, I will get that to you. All right. Thank you. Now, before we move forward, I want us to get a little defrosted. It seems just a little stiff in here. And we rebuke stiffness. And so, we didn't come to watch a show. We came to lift up Jesus. And everybody in here ought to be a worshiper. So do we have any worshipers in the house right now? One. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. 9, 10, 11, 12. Most people stop at 20, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. As long as you want.
Our sisters and our brothers in this place this morning, oh God. in a special, in a real way. The Lord is moving in this place, and let's just feel after the Holy Ghost for a moment. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's sing it without music, and I want to hear you sing this to the Lord. I love you, Jesus. Right out here. Some of you may remember that message Pastor preached about high praise and low praise. And the high praise is the praise that he doesn't have to ask for. It's the praise that we just offer to him because it just flows out from us, from the depths of our being, from our heart, from our soul. That low praise is when we look and we say, praise the Lord, everybody. And that's good to just praise him and love him because it's asked for. But it's so much better when we begin to just reach out to him from what we're feeling deep down inside. Something that doesn't have to be asked for, but it just flows from us. Let's do it again. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you. Time, let's sing it again. I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus.
I worship you, Lord.
I worship and adore you.
Hallelujah.
Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you more than anything.
Tells us we need to move on, but the Spirit of the Lord wants to linger here for a moment. Oh yes, Jesus. Come on, sing it again. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. I worship and adore you. If you're not lifting your hands, you need to be lifting your hands, telling the Lord how much you love him.
Jesus, I love you.
Come on, lift your hands and tell him.
I worship and adore you. Lord, I want to tell you. Lord, I love you. I worship and adore
you.
Just want to tell you, Lord, I love you. Lord, I need you. Hallelujah.
Come on, you sing it now. You sing it.
I love you, Jesus.
I love you, Jesus. Just worship him for a moment. Come on, tell him how much you love him. Let him tell you how much he loves you. I love you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Jesus. I love you, Jesus. If you're not standing, let's stand this morning. Amen. The presence of the Lord is here. Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Why don't we lift our hands and just love on the Lord for a moment? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The word of the Lord has gone forth. The word of the Lord has gone forth. And it's a call, a calling word. If you're here today and the word of the Lord has spoken to you, don't leave. Don't leave this building until you have fulfilled the voice of the Lord in your life. Hallelujah. I'm thankful that he cares enough about us to speak to us. How about you? Are you thankful for that? I'm thankful for that. Amen. And what a sweet presence of the Lord, like a light rain falling down on us. Hallelujah. I'm thankful for that. Amen. And choir, we'll hear that song tonight, the next song. Thank you very much. Amen. We could have had a thunderstorm, but that's not what God's calling for right now. He's calling for a light rain. Amen. He rained down on us. So good to see each and every one of you. Brother and Sister Hicks. Amen. Brother Ricky Hicks and Sister Camille Hicks. Amen. Are visiting with us this weekend. We're certainly glad to see them. Amen. If you have your Bibles, get your Bibles out. Hallelujah. We are so thrilled. I guess I just sort of took over, Pastor. I'm sorry. We are so thrilled to have my grand pastor. And amen. Pastor Wright and Sister Wright with us again. We had such a wonderful time last Sunday. Hallelujah. And we're just so thankful that they were able to be back with us again this morning. And we anticipate God moving in our life. How many want God to speak to you as an individual? Come on, how many want God to speak to you as an individual? That's what the word of the Lord is. It's an individual word. Amen. It's a corporate word, but we'll leave here today with an individual word to each and every one of us. Amen. Brother Glenn Morano, run up here real quick with your card. Yeah, run up here real quick. Come on, come on. Amen. Brother Glenn Morano, along with some men, got together, I assume it's several people, and wanted to give Brother Wright a little gift. Amen. And I'll let him open that. Amen. Well, why don't you lift your hands, and why don't we ask God to bless today as His Word goes forth. Our hearts are open. Our minds are ready to receive what thus saith the Lord. In Jesus' name we ask, God, Your Spirit is already present. Now we ask, Lord Jesus, that we are receptive to Your Word, God. That Your Word would be planted inside of us. That, Lord, that it would take root, God. That the seed would take root. That it would grow, God, and it would bear fruit in our life. We thank You for this opportunity and privilege. And we ask, God, that Your will be done in each of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say amen. Amen. Why don't we give the Lord a hand praise as Pastor Wright comes.
Thank you, Pastor Sean, Libby. It is an honor to be back with you today. And I appreciate this honor. I guess I'm supposed to open this now. It's Burger King gift card and coupons. You could put that in my case, I think. My wife does not appreciate that. I don't need any encouragement to go to Burger King, but I appreciate it. Thank you very much. I don't want to embarrass anybody, but I really need you to help me with this. I need to get a feel for how much review I need to do to get to part three. How many of you were not here last week? Okay, all right. It's part two. There was introduction, part one last week, and then this is part two. And I won't, it's only the Lord knows if there's more parts. I will not incriminate myself at this point. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, reading verses that I read last week. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning with verse 9. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, that's if the preceding verses talked about being present or absent in the body. Wherefore we labor, that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of Him. In other words, we're not just trying to be saved. We don't want to just be accepted of Him after we're dead. There is an acceptance from Him that is available and is important while you're still alive. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that everyone, everybody say everyone. That's not just people that go to church. That's every breathing individual. That everyone may receive the things done in his body according to that he had done, whether it be good or bad. There are consequences to everything we do and not do. For everybody, person that doesn't believe there's a God, to the most devoted follower of Jesus, there are consequences for everything we do and not do. Knowing, therefore, this word know there is epigenosko, and it means to not only know thoroughly, but it means to know by experience. This isn't theoretical knowledge. This is experiential knowledge. Knowing, therefore, the terror or the fear of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also are made manifest in your consciences. You may be seated. I promise to be as brief as the Spirit of the Lord will allow me to be. But there is a deep move in the presence of God in this building today. And more than my concern of displeasing you is my concern over displeasing Him. And so I will do the very best I can to be as brief as He will allow me to be. Okay. I just want them to know I'm aware. Okay. Again, just by briefly, by way of review, the Scripture teaches us that you and I, every individual, will be held accountable by the Creator of everything we have done and everything we have not done. This world wants to live in denial of the existence of God because this world does not want to be accountable. People want to live by their own definition of what's good and bad, right and wrong. But there's a problem even with that. Because as Paul said, the things that I would do, I don't do. And the things that I would not do, that I do. So even if you believe something is wrong or you believe there's something you should do, that's no guarantee you're going to do what you should do and not do what you shouldn't do. There's no guarantee just because you have an opinion or a faith on something that you're going to live in a consistent life in accordance with what you believe. That's why no one here can save themselves. I've had the Holy Ghost 56 years, and I can tell you right now, I need a Savior as much today as I've ever needed a Savior. In fact, I need a Savior more today than I did before I received the Holy Ghost, because the things I did before I was saved, I did in ignorance. The sins that a Christian commits, they don't do those in ignorance. So it doesn't matter if you are saved, you don't ever stop needing a Savior. He that endureth unto the end, the same shall be saved. There's not a point where you can say, I have arrived, until you're standing around the throne and He said, well done. None of us have arrived. So there is a need that we have to participate with Him. Jesus said it this way, Matthew 11, beginning with verse 29. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. I love the terminology here. I love the mental imagery of this. Come unto me, all ye that labor. And when you study that Greek word out, what it's really talking about is not laboring to survive life. It's speaking of the person who desires to please God and finds it to be a struggle. And he said, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. And that's actually a nautical term. And the laden of a ship is the cargo that it carries. And a nautical engineer has to calculate the amount of cargo or laden that a ship can carry in order for that ship to be as stable as possible in storms. You think you don't want to live your life without any burdens. But a ship without any cargo sits too high in the water. And that's fine on a calm sea. It's not fine in a storm. A ship without any load in it is very unstable and easily capsizes. And when the Lord took that terminology and brought it to us, he is saying to you and I that he, as our divine architect, engineer, designed our lives to be most stable when we're carrying a certain amount of load. If we have too little load, we're too hot, top heavy, and it's easy for us to capsize. If we're carrying too much load, which he's referring to here, we sit too low in the water and then we can be swamped by the storms of life. So there's a certain amount of load that is the right amount of load. But he's telling us in these verses that it's not our load he wants us carrying. Because either we don't have enough load naturally, or we have too much load naturally, and so therefore we are not stable in our existence spiritually or naturally. But he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. How do we get rest? Hebrews chapter 4 says, he that is entered into the Lord's rest hath ceased from his own labor as God did from his. That's why Peter said, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. If I cast all my care, all my load upon him, how can I survive the storms of life? I'll tell you how. Because when I give all my load to him, I'm then able to take on his load, his burden, and his burden is always perfect in the amount of weight it puts in my life so that my life is absolutely the most stable. And that's how we were designed spiritually. We were designed spiritually to not live in a place where we didn't have a lot of problems on some days or we have too many problems on another. Because both of those conditions are dangerous. Have you ever seen one of those container ships going down to Chesapeake Bay that didn't have any containers and was sitting way out of the water? I wouldn't want to be out on that ship in a storm. I wouldn't want to be on that ship in a storm. It's way too top heavy. So for Christians who want God to fix all of their problems, but take all of their problems, but they're not willing to take on his burden, you're asking for him to destroy you. But for those whose lives are characterized by such meaningless or harmless words as worry and doubt and fear, which is, we don't consider those harmless because they're so common to so many of us. That's just the way we live. Worry and doubt and fear is just normal life, isn't it? For those who carry their problems and don't trust God with anything, they get so overloaded that they get easily swamped and sunk. But neither of those is the will of God. He said, if I will come to him, he will take away my labor. He will take away my heavy load, all of that. He will take all of mine upon himself. But then the salvation is, I then get in the yoke with him. Now I want you to notice, he changes metaphors there. His first metaphor, verse 29, is a nautical metaphor of a ship. In the second metaphor, it's the metaphor of a yoke with oxen who are doing labor. The only purpose of a yoke is to do work. But he is saying that if we will give him all of our load, all of our burdens, and then take on his yoke, his burdens, what he cares about, what he gave himself for, not only will it be easy, that means it fits well, and light, meaning we won't even feel it because we're in the yoke not by ourselves but with him. I love that metaphor because I'm not a farmer, but both my grandparents were, both my grandfathers were. They didn't have oxen, they had old teams of mules. But in a yoke, typically from what I've read, the farmer will put an older, experienced oxen, strong oxen on one side, and a young and inexperienced oxen on the other. And the big, experienced oxen, he's the one that carries all the load. The only job of the other oxen is just to keep up. Not to get ahead, not to get behind, not to turn when the other oxen is not turning, not to go straight when the other oxen is turning, not to stop or go. That young oxen lets the older oxen set all the pace. And if that other oxen, us, will just keep up, just take all of our signals from the one who's in the other side of the yoke, it feels like it's no load, but we're carrying load. We're carrying enough load to keep our lives the most stable it can be, they can be, in any kind of situation. That's why if you come to the Lord and all you ever do is come to church, you come for the purpose of survival, spiritual self-preservation, just to save your own soul, just to save your own life. The problem with that is you're either always going to have too little load or too much load, and it's always going to be a struggle. And that's why so many people, after having lived for the Lord for 6 months or a year, they all of a sudden they lose that initial joy, and they said, this isn't easy, this is hard. It's hard to be a Christian. It's hard to live like this. Of course it is when you're doing it your way. Of course it's hard. And it gets especially frustrating when you're all loaded down and you want him to take all your burdens and all your problems and fix all your troubles. And you're not realizing that he can't answer that prayer without destroying you. He cannot answer that prayer without destroying you. Until he knows that you understand the only purpose for getting rid of all of your troubles is so you can participate in his burden. And until he is sure that you're going to participate in his burden, he loves you too much to take all of your troubles away. But then the problem is, you get and we get offended when we pray and pray and pray and nothing happens. And eventually we give up praying because this prayer just doesn't work. No, you're, you know, it's like, My youngest grandchild, we've got seven of them, and he just turned two this week. And he's a sweet child, and we love him and love to be around him. But he has about a 30-second or less attention span. And he's not interested in his toys. He knows where every plug is in the house. There's something about unplugging plugs and trying to plug them back in. I think he's going to be an electrical engineer, even though I'd prefer he be a preacher. All the time playing with wires. He wants to play with wires. And he's got toys. He's got a grandmother. He's got toys. And they're at the house. And he's learned quickly that the toy she buys him needs batteries, and he can say the word. And if it doesn't do exactly what he wants, batteries, he brings it to me to put batteries in. Batteries, batteries. We lose a fortune in batteries because they never turn the things off. And we're so tired after they leave, we forget to check them to make sure they're turned off. Batteries, batteries. Into everything. Knows how to work an iPad. For those of you that are my age that think they're too difficult and intimidating. Which is strictly only a mental block. Because he's two. He can turn it on, go wherever he wants on it. And you can't let him play with your phone because he resets everything. At two. That's the way we are, you see. We want it all fixed. We want to figure it all out. We want to work it up. That's us. That's how we are. But Jesus said, come unto me. Not church. I believe in going to church. But come. A lot of people come to church, never come to Jesus. A lot of people participate in religion that never participate with Jesus. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. That word in the Greek, rest, there literally means cessation from all labor. But then he says, take my yoke upon you and learn of me. You see, not only am I participating with him in his burdens, but in this relationship where he doesn't tell me to go... He doesn't tell us to go do something. He says, get in this yoke and let's do this together. He's not sitting on the throne with his dim eyes and his gray beard, looking down, just waiting with a scowl on his face, waiting for you to do something wrong. He never tells you to do anything. He only says, this is what needs to be done. Get in the yoke with me and we will do this together. In fact, he said, without me, John 15:5, without me, ye can do nothing. And that Greek word without there means separate or apart from, when there's any space in there. So the idea that the Lord has given all these rules and regulations and he's just waiting for you to make a mistake so he can smash you is so foreign to the Word of God. Everything he tells us to do, he's not telling us to do it. He's saying, join with me and we will do this. If you don't want to do wrong, then get in this yoke with me. And together we will overcome that which is wrong. If you want to do that which is right, get in this yoke with me. And together we will do what is right. But you see, that yoke is just not... for the purpose of going through your daily life so you cannot do what you shouldn't do and do what you should do. No. No, the purpose is, he said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. He's got a burden? Yeah. He told Pilate, for this cause was I born, for this cause came I into the world. Your salvation, my salvation, was his burden. The salvation of the 7+ billion people in this world is his burden. Your neighbor, your coworker, your family friend, family, your friends, they're his burden. You are not in the yoke with Jesus if you're only in it expecting him to help you with your problems every day. It's his yoke. It's his burden. And a lot of people come to church and they think prayer's only for the purpose of solving their problems. But it's not for that purpose. It's not for that purpose. The purpose is to get in his yoke, to fellowship with him, and to bear his burdens. He said, there's two things you'll learn about me if you truly fellowship with me. You can always tell if a person is truly fellowshipping with Jesus in his purpose. They reveal that by their attitude about him. The one man with the single talent said, I knew you were a hard man. I knew you were a hard man. I hid this talent so that I could return it to you because I knew you were a hard man, reaping where you have not sown. I knew you were a hard man. Your expectations are unrealistic. And so I was so afraid of you that I hid this talent so I could give it back to you. The man condemned himself because the Lord said, I'm going to judge you according to what your opinion of me. That's who you believe me to be. That's who I'm going to be to you. Take that talent that he's preserved and give it to somebody else. Because at the very least, the Lord said, you should have given this talent, this money, this gift, these whatever, to the money lender so they could have made some interest off this. But you kept it, preserved it for yourself alone, and you are a wicked and slothful servant. Now, that's strong language, folks. I'm so glad they're not my words. I'm glad they're not my words. Because the person who's experienced the touch of God on their life, who's been brought to the Holy Ghost, to the Lord and his mercy by the drawing of his Spirit and by the good news of his word, who's experienced the washing of the blood through repentance and water baptism as God has taken away all of their sins, who's experienced the infilling of the love of God by the receiving of the Holy Ghost according to Romans chapter 5 and verse 5. The person that has experienced all of that but has no desire to see somebody else receive that, experience that, there's something wrong. And the Lord says of that person, you are a wicked and slothful servant. I'm not trying to be unkind here today. But religion says, as long as you dot the I's and cross the T's, you're okay. But Jesus doesn't say that. I've had people say, when I preach this kind of message, well, you're preaching, we're saved by works. Oh, no. No, you can't do enough to be saved. Participating with Jesus and all of this doesn't save you by earning something. It saves you by giving you the opportunity to participate with him who's greater than you in his burden, which is greater than yours. And it lets you get to know him in two dimensions. You can't know him any other way. Look at verse 30 again. Verse 29. He says, when you get in my yoke with me and participate in my burden, you learn that I am meek and lowly in heart. Show me somebody that understands that about God. I'll show you somebody that has understood the importance of being involved with him in his yoke, pulling his burden with him. That's the only way you learn that about him. Everything, every other attitude about God comes from a false perception where there's distance between you and him, where you're trying hard. Why won't God cut me any slack? Doesn't he know how hard I'm trying? Doesn't he know how much effort I'm putting into this? Why doesn't he cut me some slack? You condemn yourself out of your own mouth. You prove you don't know him. You prove you're not in his yoke. You prove you're not participating with him. Because when you find him and learn of him, you find out he's meek. That's King James. The Greek word is literally, he's gentle. He's not a hard, harsh, cruel, uncaring, unfeeling taskmaster that's just looking for a way to smash you. He is gentle. And the scripture says he's lowly in heart. That comes from one Greek word that literally speaks of a degree of humility that doesn't compel him to vindicate himself on every individual immediately vindicate himself on every individual who challenges him or fails him. Oh, friend, let me tell you something right now. You need to learn that God is gentle and that he's humble enough that he can still love you even when you're blowing it. That's not an excuse to blow it. That doesn't mean it's okay to blow it. It just means he understands I was made out of dirt. The scripture says he knows my frame, that it was made of the dust. He knows. You know, when I fail God, you know who's more shocked? Not him. God's not shocked when I fail. He may be disappointed, but he's not shocked. Because he said in advance that without him I could do nothing. And you know what my problem is and your problem is? We got this old stuff called flesh. And flesh is always trying to do it for God. I call it the Pentecostal preposition. Live for God, work for God. I'd like somebody to give me book, chapter, and verse on that. Show me any place where the Lord ever told us he wanted us to live for him and work for him. He wanted to be with us, and he wants us to labor with him. The apostolic preposition is with. The Pentecostal preposition is for. So being involved with the lost is not a task. It's not another obligation. It's not an unreasonable expectation on your time and schedule. It is the opportunity to fellowship with him like you'll never know. Let me tell you something. I thank God for the joy that came into my life when I received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That was wonderful. Oh, that's wonderful. But at the very best, that joy can only remain. That's what Jesus said. These things have I spoken unto you, that your joy might remain. But that my joy, excuse me, that my joy might remain, but that your joy may be full. The joy of the Lord is what I receive when I receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost. The only thing it can do is remain. It's either there or not there. But my joy can be full. And what is the joy? What is my joy that has a fullness to it? That can always increase, can always get greater. It's the joy of the laborer in his harvest. It's the joy of the person who experiences what God does not for them, but what God does through them. Because when God is doing stuff for me, I am limiting God. When your focus is what God is doing for you, you're limiting God. How are you limiting God? Because if it's the focus is on you, you are a container. But when the limitation on that container is taken away, and that limitation on the container is me, I'm what makes me a container. My will, my way, what I want him to do for me. So I can only be filled with the Holy Ghost. And once I'm full, that's all of God I can have. Oh, you can have Holy Ghost poured out of you. Yeah? Yeah, if I stood here with this glass and I began to pour water out of that thing in here, when this glass got full and it overflows, what good's coming of that? This is a new carpet, new building. He might smile, but he's not going to be real happy about me pouring water all over his carpet. Uh-huh. That's not the way it works, you see. That's not his plan, you see. The only positive overflow there is to being full is called speaking with other tongues. That's positive overflow. Jesus said, he that believeth on me, as the scripture hath said, out of his belly, his innermost being, literally in the Greek, his cavity that is now full, shall flow rivers of living water. And that word flow, that's the only time in the entire Greek New Testament that it's translated flow. Almost every other time it's speak or say, and usually of supernatural utterance. But the Lord used the metaphor of being full of this river of life, of living water, and it flowing out in a supernatural utterance. And that's positive. And it doesn't ever need to stop. It's not a one-time thing. It's not a one-time-a-day thing. But it's the Spirit of the Lord works in my life, and I learned to give up my will and cast all my cares on Him and quit carrying all my burdens myself, so that I'm now qualified to be involved with Him, because He won't put on us more than we can bear. And He's not going to put His burden on you while you're carrying your own. Some people say, well, you know, I'd really like to be involved with the lost, but I just don't feel it. You just condemned yourself. You just said you're not casting your troubles on the Lord. He's not going to put His burden on you while you're carrying all yours. And the fact that your whole focus is preservation, self-preservation, spiritual survival, tells God that you're not a candidate for His burden. Because He can't put His burden in your life on top of your burdens. So if I want His burdens, I got to cast all of mine. I've got to give up all of my burdens to Him. That's called peace. And if I give up all my burdens and cares and troubles and problems and pain to Him, He gives me peace. And in that peace, I can now join in the yoke with Him and participate in His burden. But I don't ever lose my peace. He wants you to have peace. He wants you to have peace. The burden of the Lord will enable you to feel compassion for the lost, because it's His love for them. It's His compassion for them working through you. But it won't ever take your peace away. And the beautiful thing is, Brother Murata, if I've got peace, and Sister Johnson, the Lord wakes me up in the middle of the night and I feel a disturbance, because I've got peace, I don't immediately go to my troubles. Okay, Lord, what do you want to do? What do you want to say? What do I need to pray? Because I feel you troubling my spirit, and it's not for me. But you can't have peace when you're full of anxiety and stress over carrying all your own troubles. And you can't be involved with the lost when that's the case. And all of these things are spiritual road marks on your journey. These are indicators on your journey. Would you really want to drive a car with the speedometer not working, with the gas gauge not working, with the oil pressure gauge not working? Would you really want to? Would it operate? Yeah. But you can't operate it safely. The gauges aren't there to control you. The gauges are there to let you know how you're doing. How are you doing? How are you doing? How much pressure did you bring in here today? Jesus said, these are the last words of Jesus to the apostles before he went out to Gethsemane to pray. John 16, I think, 25, I think, or 24, whatever the last verse of that chapter is, John 16. I want you to get this. He's talked to them all through chapter 14, 15, 16, after the Last Supper, and just before he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray, and later on he's taken captive by his allowing them to, and then crucified that day, later that day. Here are his last words. These things have I spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. Not you will, you might. In the world ye shall have tribulations. The Greek word there for tribulation is philipsis. It's pressure, pain, problem, difficulties. Anything that causes pressure in here. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. What does he mean? I shall have trouble, but I might have peace. Because the trouble's not your choice. The peace is. You can't stop the trouble from coming. It's coming. I don't care if you believe the Bible's the Word of God or not. I guarantee you that's one verse that's come to pass in your life. In the world, you shall have trouble, pain, problems, pressure. You don't have a choice with that. But you do have a choice whether or not you have peace. You have to be willing to cast all your cares upon Him. All that labor and all that heavy load, cast it on Him. And He said, you will cease from all of your labor. That's the Greek word. But in the next verse, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest. Same word in the King James, but it's a different word in the Greek. The second word doesn't mean rest from labor. The second word, rest, means rest in your labors. How can I labor and have rest? Because I'm not doing it alone. I'm in the yoke with Him. He's pulling the load. That's right. He's pulling the load. Luke 16, verse 19. There was a certain rich man. This is not a parable. When that Greek word for certain means there was a specific man. The Lord just didn't give us his name. If you were that rich man, would you want everybody to know your name? The Lord was kind even to this man who was lost. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate, full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. That's the only ministration he received. And it came to pass the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom, also called paradise. The rich man also died and was buried, and in hell he lifted up his eyes. I can't tell you how disturbing this passage of Scripture is. Can't tell you how disturbing. First of all, it's a specific story. The rich man really lived, and this was really the situation with him. And there was a poor man named Lazarus, and he really lived, and he was there. And they both died, and Lazarus goes to paradise, the place for the saved people at that time, before the cross. And the rich man died and went to hell. And here's what's so disturbing. Search the Scripture from cover to cover. Read this, every Greek word. Get you the best Greek scholar there is, and show me what the rich man did to go to hell. He didn't go to hell because he was rich. He went to hell because he lived for himself. He didn't even have time. He didn't have to do it, but himself specifically. He had enough servants. He could have sent them out there. He could have welcomed the man into his house, found him a place to be comforted and ministered to. He didn't have to bathe the man himself. He had servants that could have bathed. He didn't have to feed the man himself. He had servants that could have fed the man. But they didn't do anything because they weren't instructed to do it. And the man was, this poor man was laid at the rich man's gate. That means every time he left the house, every time he came home, he had to walk by and ignore that man. Not just one day, not just 2 days, not just a week, not just a month. Only the Lord knows how long Lazarus laid there. Long enough that the rich man convinced God this wasn't just a bad day for him. It was a bad life. To the outside, he looked like he had it all together. I'm sure there were a lot of people envied this man. He fared sumptuously every day. That meant he ate really good. That meant he had Whoppers for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. He ate really, really good. He fared sumptuously every day. This man at his gate would have been thankful just for crumbs. Crumbs! And God sent dogs to lick his sores just so he could get some comfort. Before the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ from the grave, Hades is the Greek word here, we translate hell, had three parts. It had a part called Abraham's bosom, or also called paradise. It was a part that was consumed with fire. And then there was a great divide called King James Great Gulf that separated the two. After the resurrection of Jesus, everybody in Abraham's bosom or paradise left that place with him, and they moved to a place the Bible calls the third heaven. The third heaven is now also called paradise, letting us know same people, except those that have been added to it, same people, different location. That's why the Old Testament prophesied there would be a day when hell would enlarge itself. And scientists, geologists, have confirmed that the core of the earth has significantly heated up over the last 2,000 years. Meaning all that great gulf, the space taken up by the great gulf and paradise, is now molten fire. You say, that's far-fetched, preacher. I'm sorry, believe it or not, it's true. But it's only a temporary holding place. When you get arrested, they put you in the county detention center. After your trial and you're sentenced, more than likely you're going to the state or federal penitentiary, which is long-term. Very few people are left in the county detention center. Well, I respect the fact that people have a right to believe what they want to, and there are people that believe in a place called purgatory. The problem is there is no purgatory in the Bible. As a tree falleth, so shall it lie. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. There's no second chance. There's no second chance. There's no second chance. The decisions you're making sitting here today are going to determine where you spend forever. And you see, that's our problem. And the Lord understands this. He understands that we have such a hard time getting past seeing the natural, the temporary, to seeing the eternal. Because the eternal can only be seen with the spiritual eye. But it can be sensed. Some of you, even those of you that are here for your first time, earlier today as we were singing and worshiping, there was, here's the words, something moving in this place. That's what Paul told the great philosophers on Mars Hill in Athens in Acts chapter 17, I believe it is. He said, you got an altar here to an unknown God, but I've come to tell you who that is. He said, he's the God created all this. He's the one in whom you live and move and have your being. And if you want to know him, you got to feel after him. Oh, I don't like that. I want a God that I can find intellectually. You want a God who is presence. Because if our God is to be found first and foremost intellectually, then what about the people either that don't have the intellectual ability to do that? What about those who are too young to have their intellect developed enough to find God? So then God would be a respecter of persons. But he is no respecter of persons. So therefore, you do not initially find God by intellect. You initially find God by feeling after him. Why? Because everybody of any age and any mental capability can find God by feeling after him. Because he's not very far from any one of us. Can you feel that here right now? Right now, can you feel him manifesting himself?
I don't know if I feel anything.
That's because it's so gentle. He's so gentle. But you can feel him. You can feel him. And once you feel him, you can find him if what you're feeling causes you to hunger and thirst after what you're feeling. Because you see, we're all born empty. And every one of us spends our lives trying to fill that emptiness. And some of you, all of us, have put all kind of stuff in there over the years trying to fill it. It doesn't work. There's only one, not one thing, only one who can fill your emptiness. Only one. He's the only one that can fill your emptiness. Nobody and nothing else. Not the best, most beautiful, loving wife or the handsomest, best-looking husband. Not the ability to buy anything you want to buy or go anywhere you want to go. Not pleasure without restrictions and restraints. None of those things can fill that emptiness. They're all temporary. Well, when he fills your emptiness, oh my. But that's the beauty of this. If it's awesome when I receive it from me, how much more awesome is it when he touches somebody through me? I'm kind of selfish, you know. Over the years, I really kind of like to move my way in and get my hand on somebody's head to pray for them. It's just a little bit of selfishness, and I got to be honest with you. Because when he's flowing through me to them, oh my, nothing like it. And that's not just for preachers. I received the Holy Ghost at age 12. My dad was stationed in the Navy in Jacksonville, Florida. That's the only church in all the years we moved all over the country, in all of my lifetime, it's the only church I've ever been in where the young people were the only altar workers. The adults sat back in altar service and let the young people do it all. So that was the culture I received the Holy Ghost in. So it was not even a question what I was going to do the next Sunday night. After the preacher was through the next Sunday night, there was an altar service. I went down to the front with all the other young people, put my hands on kids' heads, people's heads, adults' heads, and began to pray. And I learned how to let the Spirit of the Lord flow through me at 12. Because the Spirit is no respecter of persons. It didn't matter to him the vessel was 12. It just mattered that somebody was willing to let him flow. If all you ever do is come to church and feel goosebumps, I feel so sorry for you. I mean that sincerely. You don't know my Jesus. You don't have any clue what this is all about. This is so much better than just church. Some of the greatest live times of my life, and I know you guys know what I'm talking about here, is sitting across a table with a Bible study chart, talking to a sinner, and watching as words he's giving me to say begins to affect that person. You can see it in their eyes. And then you're sitting there, just there's no music, there's no singing, there's no hype, as some people think this is. No, it's just word and spirit. And all of a sudden, tears begin to flow down their face, and you got to restrain yourself, because what you want to do is get up, jump up and down, run around that table a few times. But you don't, because that would put the focus on you, and you don't want this flow to stop. You just want it to flow and flow and flow, because there's nothing better. It's addicting. I got a confession to make. I'm a wino. Because the Holy Ghost is called new wine. And I love to drink and let that new wine flow through me, especially to somebody else. I love it. 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 If you're not experiencing that, precious brothers and sisters, you don't know what you're cheating yourself out of. You think it's inconvenient? No, it's not inconvenient. It's not inconvenient at all. It makes life worth living. It takes the focus off of you, and all of a sudden your big problems get really small. You've seen this 1,000 times. If I hold my hand up right here, my hand, the bottom of my hand is to the bottom of those doors, and the top of my hand goes all the way to the top of that second opening up there, almost to the roof. That's how big my hand is. But you don't see that perspective, because that's only mine. Because I got this between me and all of that that's God out there. But I move this out of the way and focus on that, all of a sudden, that becomes big and this becomes little. You can't see how big God is when your only focus is on you trying to get God to fix all your trouble. Instead of letting the Lord work and flow through you, you'll never see how big God is. You'll never know how great and wonderful, kind, good, and merciful He is. You'll never know that. I'm winding down. Let me finish reading this a little bit. So the verse in Luke 16, it says, "In hell he lift up his eyes." I got it printed out as a paragraph, so I don't know what verse that is. "And in hell, meeting the rich man, lift up his eyes, being in torments." Plural. Not singular. Torments. I don't have the time to preach it today, but I preach a message called "The Seven Horrors of Hell." And fire is the least of the seven. "Being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried," the rich man cried, "and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame." Lazarus laid at his gate every day. Rich men came and went. Lazarus would have been thankful for crumbs, just somebody to bathe him once in a while, just a little safer place to sleep out of the elements. Rich man was too busy with all his riches. But look how everything has turned. The rich man right now is wanting the poor man to cross over this great divide and bring one drop of water. That's what he prayed for. He didn't pray to be delivered from hell. He prayed for one drop of water to comfort him. How horrible must hell be that one drop of water would be an answer to a prayer and would be considered comforting. But listen to what Abraham said. But Abraham said, "Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now," everybody say now. Oh, precious brothers, sisters, guests, friends, are you judging life by this now? Because there's coming another now that everything's going to be revealed for what it really is. If you're judging life, determining value in life for you and others by this now, you're going to be really, really, really shocked and disappointed over that. But now, he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And besides all this, between us and you, there's a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us, but would come from thence. That would come from thence. Then he said, I pray thee therefore. The rich man's now praying in hell. He started off praying for himself, but now he's praying. I pray thee, Father Abraham, that thou wouldest send him, Lazarus, to my father's house. For I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Did you hear me? The man that didn't have a few moments to even give an order to take care of a poor, afflicted fella laying at his gate has now become truly evangelistic. Would you send, if Lazarus can't come to me, would you let him be resurrected from the dead and sent to my father's house? So that he could preach to my brothers, because I don't want them to come here. You think people in hell are going to say, with the anger and bitterness that some of us carry around now, they deserve that, they deserve that? No. There isn't going to be anybody in hell that wishes that others would come and join them. Everybody in hell is going to pray in their own heart of hearts that somehow their loved ones not go to that place. I've had people say, well, if what you preach is true, preacher, you're saying my grandmother's lost. I don't believe that. Well, let me tell you what your grandmother would tell you right now. If she's not saved, she'd be begging God to do whatever he could do to keep you from letting her be your excuse to not get saved in the truth. How can my sweet old grandmother go to hell? I'll tell you how. Because she wasn't always your sweet old grandmother. And God remembers all the stuff she did before she became your sweet old grandmother that she never repented of. The only do-over in this life is the blood of Jesus. You don't get do-overs by making up your mind to be a better person. You don't get do-overs because you grow up and suddenly realize what you've been doing is wrong and I'm going to start doing right. The only do-over in this life that works is the blood of Jesus. And you got to believe and repent and be baptized to have that blood applied to your life. I'm hurrying, honestly. That's what it says. Send him to my brothers so they don't come to this place of torment. I wonder how many people in hell today are praying these kind of prayers that somebody would get to their loved ones so they don't end up in that place. I wonder. I wonder. But this is what Abraham said. Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. That's the Bible. I know this is an iPad, but there's about 25 Bibles in here, so we'll count that, won't we? Right? Moses said, they've got the Bible. Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he, Abraham, said unto him, the rich man, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But how do we persuade men? We persuade men with the Word of God. I told someone after service last Sunday morning, the problem for preachers is we know the Word, the law, too well. That's why the Bible says that you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me. A witness simply tells people what you've experienced. If you try to debate doctrine with somebody, they can deny it. They don't have to believe what you're saying. They don't have to agree with your doctrine. But if you tell somebody what happened to you, what you don't have to give them the gory details, but what you were like, how the Lord brought you to Him, what you experienced, what you felt, they'd have to call you a liar and say that didn't happen to you. 99.9% of the people won't. That's what being a witness is. That's what being a witness is. You don't have to be able to dot all the I's, cross all the T's of the doctrine before you open your mouth to somebody. Tell them what you've experienced. Tell them what you feel. Tell them what God did for you. And let me tell you something right now. If you have not done that, you don't understand the benefit of that. I've been going through some bad stuff at times. Get started witnessing somebody and start talking to them how good God was, how great things were, all that He had done for me. And when I was through, I don't know how they were feeling, but I was feeling a whole lot better. Because telling them what God had done for me reminded me of what He'd done for me. And then everything that was so heavy for me at the point in time. No, that's not important. The only thing that's important is what He's done for me. And what I'm going to let Him do through me. Nothing else really matters. I'll close with this verse. Acts 28, verses 23 and 24. I'm going to prove to you that what Abraham said was true. When they had appointed him a day, there came many to him into his lodging, speaking of Paul, to whom he, Paul, expounded and testified that the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law and the prophets, from morning until evening. I don't preach that long. And some believed the things which were spoken, and some believed not. I think it is a reasonable assumption based on Paul's own testimony in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 that Paul had been stoned to death and resurrected from that pile of stones. He was one raised from the dead and came preaching Moses and the prophets. Some believed, some did not. But you know what the Lord does? He never gives us the right to choose who's going to believe and who does not. Our job is to tell them. He and they make the decision who's going to listen and who doesn't. So the fact that you witness to people and they don't come to church, that's not your problem anymore. It's not your problem anymore. It's not your problem anymore. It's not your problem anymore. You have participated with Jesus. You've obeyed him. You've shared with them Moses and the prophets as he led you to. What they do with it then is their business. That's why Paul said, we are the savor, and that's not savior. Savor is a smell. We are the smell of life unto some and the smell of death unto others. There are some people sitting here today, they've listened to this, and they fuss with me everything I've said. Right down in here, fussed and fumed over everything I said. And there are people sitting right next to them, they're going, oh, yes, yes. That's exactly what I needed. I needed to hear that. Oh, thank you, Jesus, for talking to me. One says, forget that. I don't believe a word of that. And the other one says, oh, yes. But you know the problem? Both are going to stand before God and be judged not by me and not by this church, not by this pastor, but by the one sitting on the throne for how you responded to the word. I'm just the messenger. I got a question for you. I've asked this question so many times, so many places. If I'm not mistaken, I've asked this question here in the past a few years ago. The people of hell are praying that someone will go to their loved ones. That's what Jesus said. Jesus is the one that told that story. He's the one that knew what was going on. He's God manifest in the flesh. The people of hell are praying for their loved ones, for somebody to talk to their loved ones so they won't be lost. I've got a question for you. If you were lost and your eternal destiny was totally dependent on somebody just like the Christian you are right now, with the attitude about God and the lost and your schedule and your time and your burdens, that person who is the only person that's supposed to reach you, what if that person who's just like the person you are right now and you were the one lost, what if they were your only hope of not going to hell? What chance would you have of being saved? What chance would you have of being saved if you were lost and your only hope of being saved was somebody just like you right now is the one who was to reach you? What chance would you have? The Spirit of the Lord said he called us to repentance. I know this is a wicked world. This is a wicked world. But it's not what people do in bars and whorehouses that are sending people to hell. It's not really as much the things we do that sends us and others to hell. For the believer, the most damning sin for us and others is he that knoweth to do good and doeth it not. To him it is sin. I got a question. Is it good to carry the good news to the lost? Is it good to witness to people about the goodness of Jesus in your life? Is it good for the Lord to pray, to pray to the Lord for him to do whatever he's got to do to get a person's attention so that they might decide whether or not they want to be saved? Is that good? So you see, for believers, the believers that end up lost most likely won't be lost because of what they do. We'll be lost because of what we don't do that we should have done. The guy kicking back his bottle of gusto today. He may be cheating his family. He's cheating himself. It's not good. He's seeking comfort from an artificial stimulus so he doesn't have to give his life and will to God. And that's not good. Kids, wife involved, that's really sad. But friend, when a baptized in Jesus' name, Holy Ghost filled, one God believer walks into a church, takes their fill, and goes home about their way, and never cares about the eternal destiny of people that live in darkness and don't know truth and don't know God. That's far worse than what that guy's doing on that bar stool. That's far worse than what that person's doing camped out over a computer exploring porn sites. And I'm not saying that's good. I'm just saying this is far worse. Because what that person's doing, they're doing to themselves. But our sins of omission are affecting tens and thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. I'm not taking any credit at all, but you know, you've heard the story. It was between the holidays. It was in between Christmas and New Year's when I knocked on Brother and Sister Libby's door. I had a good excuse. It was the holidays. I picked this back up afterwards. Well, what if somebody without the truth had gotten to the door and was persuasive enough to get them in something involved in something that wasn't truth because I was too busy or it was inconvenient or wasn't right season? I'm not taking the credit, you understand. I'm just an earthen vessel. What if God hadn't found somebody who was willing to take a little bit of time that day to go to a door? Well, wait a minute here. If I had not gone and the Lord had not done in their lives what he's done, do you have any idea how many hundreds of thousands of people that would not have been affected by this man and this lady's life and ministry simply because that day I wouldn't have had time? Really? Really? So the Spirit has called us to repentance, and I don't want you to come down front. I don't want any moving, going around. If you got to leave, you got to go to the bathroom, that's your business. But if you could just bow your head where you are and let the light of the gentle, humble Savior shine into your heart. So then the light, the pure light of his loving Spirit, you can see yourself and your attitude and your time and the decisions you make. If you could see that and say, am I really willing to stand before God and say, that person in that restaurant you told me to talk to, it was okay for me to be more concerned over my embarrassment than their eternity in hell. I really didn't have time to go to that door. Really, I didn't want to talk to this coworker because I didn't want to disturb the workplace, and I didn't want to take sides. I don't want them to treat me strange in this workplace. Can you really tell the Lord that your convenience and comfort was worth letting a person go to hell? But see, not just them. Not just them. But you don't know what that person would have ended up being in God. You don't know what they would have been. You don't know what they would have been. So you don't know how many people that person's life and potential ministry would have affected if you'd have just taken a few moments of your time. And it's not even a trial. It's a joy. And it not only lets his joy remain in you, but it gives you an opportunity for your joy to be full. And it lets you participate with him in his yoke so you can get to know him as he really is, not like you think he is. There's all benefits in it. There's no trial in it. There's no unpleasantness in it. Not really. Those are all lies and threats of the devil. I know it's quiet. It's supposed to be quiet. It's just between you and Jesus. You don't know how much God there is in here. Feel after him in a minute. You'll feel how much God's in here. He loves you individually, and he loves you as a church. He's made great promises to this church. He's got great things. The future of this church is ahead of it. Is it possible that everything that's been done up to this point was foundational to get you to this place so God could do all those things he's promised? And the awesome thing is, some have come and some have gone, but you're here. That means you've made it far enough to be a part of what God's wanting to do here. It's got to stop being about inconvenience. Well, you're asking for a big sacrifice, Brother Wright. No, you're not your own. You were bought with a price. You got to own something to sacrifice anything. Something needs to happen in here today. The Spirit of the Lord did the prelude, the introduction to this message, saying he's called us to repentance. You show me a person that's trying to live for God just for themselves, I'll show you a person that will not survive spiritually. They will eventually not make it. They will eventually begin to look for other things to fill an emptiness that they've let get empty because it was once full. There's some that are having to leave, and that's fine. It's really okay. But I can't stop what the Holy Ghost is doing right now. There's some people's lives that are changing today. There's some people's directions changing today. There's some people in this room that over the next few days or week needs to come to either Pastor Libby and say, I'm not really involved. Where do you need me? What can I do? What can I get involved in so that I can be involved with the lost? What training programs do you have that I can take advantage of right now so that I can get better equipped as I get involved with the lost so that I can be effective? Some of you need to come to them and say that before the week's out. Here I am. Forgive me for not being involved. But I see. My eyes are open. I see. I want to be involved. I want to be a part. Not of a church, not of a religious organization, but a part of Jesus, his plan, his purpose. Jesus' name. Yes, sir. Pastor just said the discovery class is not just to teach you a five-lesson Bible study, but to teach you how to teach that to others. That what a small commitment of time that is, to be better equipped so that you can sit across the table with somebody and see the tears run down their face as the Lord uses you. Let's do this for right now. We're not in this alone. Would you pray for somebody close by you? Just pray one for another. Could we do that? Could we pray one for another right now in Jesus' name? Come on. Let's just pray one for another right now. Come on. Father, I'm in this with you. I'm in this with you, Jesus. We're in this together. We're in this together, Lord. We're in this. Help my brother. Help my sister. Help us, Father, together, to give ourselves to you, to be involved in your kingdom and your plan and your purpose. Jesus, Lord, work in our lives so that we get in the yoke with you. Give us the grace to give up ourselves and to get in the yoke with you. In the name of Jesus, I want to learn about you, Jesus. I want to learn about you, Jesus. I want to learn about you, Jesus. I want to learn that you're gentle. I want to learn that you're humble. I want to learn that you're loving and kind and gracious. Lord, I don't want just the joy, your joy that you've given me to remain in me. But I want to have the fullness of my joy in me. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Come on, something's happening here right now. Come on, let's pray. Let's pray. If you don't know what to pray for and you have the Holy Ghost, pray in tongues. Let the Spirit pray through you. The Lord knows. Let the Lord use you to pray for yourself and others in that supernatural language. In the name of Jesus. There's some people in this room that God's calling to the ministry, but you're resisting it. Either you don't think that's what you want to do, or you don't think you're capable of doing it. You need to go to the pastor and say, would you pray with me to see whether or not the Lord's calling me to ministry, or if he's just calling me to the ministry of the church. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Come on. Come on, let's pray. Come on, let's pray. Come on, let's pray. Come on. And believer, don't let the devil beat you up over all the stuff you haven't done. Don't let the devil beat you up over all the stuff you haven't been doing. All the stuff that you have done you shouldn't have done. Come on, the blood of Jesus draws a line here today. Come on, it's a new day, it's a new opportunity, it's a new chance. The blood of Jesus draws a line in your life today and say, that's past, let's have a future together. Come on, let the blood of Jesus draw a line in your life, dear brother, sister. Come on, come on, if you haven't been involved, let's don't beat ourselves up over what we haven't done, but let's let the Lord Jesus Christ's blood be the line that separates our past from our present and our future. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Let's pray in tongues now. Jesus, everybody in the room, we know how to do it. Hallelujah. Let's pray in tongues. Pray in tongues. Don't walk away. Don't walk away. This is now your time. What are you going to do with this? What are we going to do with this? What are we going to do with this? Come on, come on, come on. Let's go a little bit more. Come on, go ahead a little more. Let's put some volume to it. Let's put some passion in it. Put some desire in it. We ought to be begging God to use us. People are depending on us. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Use us, O God. Use us, O God. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. If there's anybody in here that hasn't received the Holy Ghost speaking in tongues, if you just stand, we'll come over to you. If you have not been baptized in the name of Jesus, just stand. We'll come to you. Just stand as an indication you're interested. You want help. We'll help you. Hallelujah. 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 What if you knew there was five people that God is depending on for you to touch them in the next 2 weeks? Why don't you pray right now as if those people are depending on you, because they probably are. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Help me get past myself, Lord. Help me get past myself, so I can do the work of your work. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. That person you work near, that person that you ride the bus with, In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Let's stand together. Praise God. Praise God. In the name of Jesus. What are we going to do with this? Remember last week he taught about, as a part of this two parts, he talked about iniquity. Iniquity. And we learned that that was the very first sin. I get that right? The original sin was iniquity in Satan's heart, which meant I don't want to be controlled. I want to control myself. Iniquity. I don't want anybody telling me nothing. I don't want God telling me nothing. I want to do what I want to do. Iniquity. And where did that get him? Where did that get him? He's in a burning inferno right now and will never get out because he rebelled. Pastor, when are we going to get out of here? I don't know. Let's just stay here and keep having church the rest of the day, because eternity is being determined tonight, today. Some are going to go win that person that needs to be won, and some, sadly, probably won't. And eternity is depending on us. Wow. So the class, the discovery class, doesn't have to be just for new people. It can be a training time for you that will equip you to teach somebody a very, very, well, five lessons over once a week. That's what we're going to do. When I get all the names, I'm going to collect them and then find out whether you prefer to do it early Sunday morning or you prefer to do it Saturday. And if I have to, I'll teach it twice so everybody that can get the information and invest in training themselves to go do what God's calling them to do. Did you get that part about being in the yoke with Jesus? The troubles you have, just hand that to Him. And you focus on walking with Him, just keeping up with Him. That's the burden that's light. That's why you need a prayer life. That's why, folks, you need to be back here tonight. We're talking eternity here. And how long is that? A vapor. That's how long our life is. That's how much time we got left. We got to be doing it. You know what I'm going to do today? I'm going to find somebody to talk to. I'll tell you about it tonight. Anybody want to join me with that? Raise your hand if you'll join me with that today. And come back tonight and you tell us about it. There's probably 20 or 30 there. That's great. There's people everywhere. All they need is somebody to touch. Father, I pray over this body of believers that love you, that are sincere. Oh, let us yearn to be in your yoke. Help us to hunger for your yoke. Help us pray about being in your yoke every day, every day. Make us the men and women, young people of God. Even like Pastor Wright said about when he was 12, we can do it if we can get over ourselves and be about his will. So, Brother Morado, are you out there? All right, go out there and get ready to get names. That's for the discovery class. He'll be out in the foyer. The curriculum for helping and strengthening the hands of single parents, Sister Wood, Kitty, you here, Kitty? Please make sure somebody's there to receive those brochures. Hallelujah. Do you love your church? Do you? Do you love the Lord? Are you appreciative, Brother Wright and his wife, was it be with us for these 2 weeks? Thank you for the word, Brother Wright. Let's give God one great big praise before we leave for blessing us and showing us how we can please him more completely. Come on, a little bit more. He's worthy of it. Hanamarandiya mamaho koshotolo.